Good morning, Ridgecrest. We're so glad that you could join us this morning today for worship. Welcome to everyone here in attendance and online this morning. We're going to start this morning with a little scripture from Acts chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. Peter standing before the religious leaders, and he says, "This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven among men by which we must be saved." Let's pray this morning. Thank you, Father, that is in Christ alone that all our hope is found, and that through him we have the gift of salvation. Thank you that the same power that Peter displayed in Acts can also live in us. Christ is indeed our cornerstone. Amen. Everyone, please stand and worship with us this morning.
Then bursting forth in glorious name. Yeah.
Been to church, huh? Hey, grab a seat for just a second. My name's Shay Reiner. I'm one of the pastors here at Ridgecrest. So glad to see all you smiling, singing, worshiping faces out there. It's always our pleasure to gather as the community of saints and to worship our great God. Just a couple of announcements that I want to make. First of all, I just want to welcome those of you who are not only here in person, but who are gathering with us online. We love having you join us here. And if there's any way in which we can serve you, just let us know. There's some information, some contact information behind me. And just let us know what's going on with you so that we can pray for you, so that we can serve you, so that we can help you in any way. Couple of announcements I want to make. While I'm making these announcements, I want to invite Brett Simmons and the Bobby Salmon Connect Group class, as well as Brian and Rachel and your gals and your Connect group, the 320 Fellowship, to go ahead and be gathering up here. We're going to introduce these folks in just a minute. Announcement number one, we've got a
a family gathering at the Durham Bulls Park that we would love for you to be a part of on September 11th. We are going to be attending a baseball game together. Tickets are available this morning out in the fellowship hall. You can grab those out there. Secondly, Awana kickoff. It is almost Awana time. August 31st, we are going to be having our kickoff for Awanas, and parents, just know that we need you here to help get your kids signed up for Awana, and we're going to have a great year. That's going to be from 6:30 to 7:30. And then thirdly, Psalm 63, what we are calling a night of praise, is going to be on October the 9th. We just want you to kind of have it on your radar, on your calendar. It's going to be a great night as we gather together to worship like we've been doing this morning. So we hope that you will be here for that. So with that in mind, there's a lot of people gathered down here. Let me make my way down here and find Brett Simmons. So Brett is been around here since when? When did you start hanging out with us? About 3 months ago. He loves our church. He's already been through Membership Matters. I sat down with him this past week and had a chance to hear his story. This is his Connect group behind him, the Bobby Salmon class. We are introducing him this morning as a brother and member of our church. So welcome him this morning. And then right here we've got Brian and Rachel Taylor with their daughters Anna and Abby, who we affectionately like to call Slash. There's a whole story that goes along with that, and their Connect group, which is the 320 Fellowship led by Jared Gunn, and they have been hanging out here. They sat down with Mark, I believe, and heard your story. They have all been through Membership Matters. Welcome them also to our fellowship. Glad to have you guys, and Wayne Alford, if you would pray for us this morning.
My name is Wayne Offen, along with Scott Markham and Scott Harkman and Rodney Strickland. We're your deacons on call for this week, and we really hope that if you have a need in your family that you would call us. We'd love to pray with you about whatever the situation or help you in any way that we can. Let's pray. Father, what a great morning already. You have blessed us so much in the songs that we've sang, and we now ask that your blessing be upon our pastor, that you allow him to bring your word boldly and freely to us, Lord, that we may apply it to our life as we leave here. For in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Sometimes the pastor is tempted to say, hey, we've had a great day, let's just pack up and go home. I'm not going to do that today. I'm not going to do that. I do want you to do this as we get started with the message today. I don't want you to take just a second without getting up from your seat. Just start looking around at all the different people that are here this morning at Ridgecrest Baptist Church. You will find that in the midst of this group gathered here, there are those who are older and those who are younger. There are those who work and there are those that stay at home. There are those who are retired. There are those who are students. There are those who are single. There are those who are married. There are those who are divorced. There are those who are well off. There are those who are struggling. There are those who are longtime Christians. There are those who are new converts. There are those who are white and brown and black. There are those who are born in the United States. There are those who are born in one of at least six other countries, if I count correctly, that are a part of Ridgecrest Baptist Church. There are longtime church members, and there are those that joined 3 minutes ago. There are those who speak with an accent from another country. There are those who speak with an accent from another county. There are those who go. There are those who head to Chick-fil-A. There are those that go to Bojangles and those that go to McDonald's. There are those that dress up for church, those who dress casually for church, those who prefer traditional worship, those who prefer contemporary worship, and on and on and on the list goes. The reality is this. There's a whole lot of differences in this room. Would you agree with me this morning? We're different in so many ways, and there is one thing that brings us together and unites us as a group assembled on this occasion and also as a church known as Ridgecrest Baptist Church. And that one thing that unites us that is greater than all the things that might be different about us is our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, how we have been changed and born again, and we are headed towards heaven. And while we may be from this side or that side, speak this or that, and look like this or that, whatever the differences are, we are united in Christ. Can I get an amen to that this morning? Well, that's nothing especially new in a lot of churches. A lot of churches have a lot of differences within their congregation. I happen to believe it's a very healthy thing. It goes all the way back throughout history. And even if you go back and look at the 12 disciples who Jesus called and who followed after him, you'll find that among that group of 12 was also a lot of differences. For example, there were older and there were younger. There were a group of four of the 12 that were fishermen: Peter, Andrew, James, and John. There were one in the group that was a pessimistic doubter named Thomas. And he doubted so much that after the resurrection, he said, "I'll have to put my hand in his side to be sure that he was resurrected." There was one among them that was a thief and a betrayer. Judas, we're told, stole money from the disciples' money bag, and then betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. There was one in the group, Matthew, who was a tax collector. He was a Jewish person, but he worked for the Roman occupiers collecting taxes and was looked at as a traitor by all the Jews. Not only was he a traitor by working for the Romans, but he got his money by overcharging for the taxes. He was a double traitor in the eyes of so many. And yet oftentimes, right beside of him in the disciples is a man named Simon the Zealot. The Zealots were a political party within Judaism organized to overthrow the Romans. Can you imagine some of the conversations that Matthew and Simon must have had? There were the brothers known as the Sons of Thunder, James and John, because of their bold personalities and because of their argumentative demeanor and their judgmental spirit. There were some that were prominent and outspoken, like Peter, James, and John. There were some who were quiet and in the background, like Philip, Bartholomew, and Thaddeus. All of them were flawed. All of them were flawed. They were called by Jesus as being stubborn, hard-headed. They presented themselves as competitive and argumentative. They were flawed. How dare they be followers of Jesus and be flawed? But we're kind of in the same boat, so we can't complain. Among these 12 followers of Jesus, the most prominently known, mentioned, and talked about is a man named Peter. One commentator wrote this about Peter. Throughout the Gospels, Peter's interactions with Jesus and the disciples reflect a leader who is impulsive, ambitious, self-assertive, and quick to commit without fully understanding the meaning of Jesus' words or actions. When I read that about Peter, I feel a little better about myself. I don't know about you. Peter called himself a sinner and asked Jesus to leave. He identified Jesus as the Christ. He walked on the water before he started sinking. He denied Jesus 3 times. He was restored as a disciple, a leader in the early church. He wrote 2 letters of encouragement to Christians, and he traditionally died a martyr's death because of his faith in Jesus Christ. These disciples were vastly different, and yet there was one compelling reason that pulled them together and unified them. And that was, as it became more and more apparent, that as Peter said, Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. You see, as a church, we prioritize Jesus over everything. We prioritize Jesus over any differences that we may have as people. Our differences are vast and many, and too many even to start counting. But our unity is based only on one thing, and that is our faith in Jesus Christ. And because of Jesus, I want you to hear me clearly this morning, because of Jesus, we are called to connect to one another. Part of making Jesus the Lord of our life is following biblical commands that calls us to be connected to one another. In the New Testament, there's a Greek word that means one another. It has a mutual or a reciprocal element to it, so it tells us how we are to act towards one another. It's not just how I'm supposed to act towards you, it's how you're supposed to act towards me, how we're supposed to act towards each other. And this word in the Greek language about how we are to connect to one another, this word is used in the New Testament over 100 times. It's an important word. Of those 100 times it's used, 59 of those times are given in a command structure that tell us how to relate to each other and how not to relate to each other. Would you pray with me? Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the great unity that we have in this room and in this church in the midst of a great diversity. And may we celebrate the diversity that we have while coming together in the unity that brings us together, our faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Lord, today, as we talk about that great imperative to connect to one another, may you be in our midst. May you remind us of great truth that we already know. Would you inform us and instruct us in areas that we may not be aware? And would you give us a willing heart and a willing spirit to follow your word into every area of life as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm going to mention for you several of these 59 one another verses. I'm probably not going to get to all 59. But I've mentioned most of those in your listening guide. I hope you have that there in front of you. But these one another verses, how we are to act towards one another, how we are to connect with one another, these are essential in our faith for at least two reasons that we see laid out in Scripture. On one hand, how we, listen to how I say this, how we one another identifies us as Christians. And it testifies to the life-changing power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Among these 59 verses, one of those that describes this, what I'm saying, is found in John chapter 13 and verse 35, where Jesus says, "By this will all men know that you're my disciples. By this one thing will all people know that you're my disciples." Here's the outreach, the testimony. Here's the witness of the one anothering. "By this one thing will everyone know that you follow me, if you have love towards one another." When you love one another, the interior of the church, the building up of the church, the strengthening of the church, the foundation of the church, when you love one another, then outwardly everybody's going to know that you follow after me. Our witness is not about our buildings or our budget or our pastor or our structure or what we have going on in our programming. Our witness is all about how we love one another. You have no doubt understood by now that we're aiming towards August the 28th as a refresh as we kick off our new church year. A relaunch, if you will, a relaunching and a refreshing and a regrouping as a church. And in advance of that, I'm highlighting three important phrases that you're going to hear more and more as we go forward. Last week, how we are to connect to God. This week, how we are to connect to one another. And next week, as we are to connect to our neighbors all around the world. Today, we're talking about connecting to one another. There's two biblical values I want to point out to you in the message today that illustrate how we are to connect to one another. Two values that you'll hear more about, two values that we must prioritize as a church to be the church that God has called us to be. Here are those values, and I'll elaborate more in just a minute. Value number one, we will love generously. We will love generously. Value number two, we will serve joyfully. I don't know about you, but that describes a church I want to be a part of. I want to be a part of a church that's going to love each other generously and serve each other joyfully. It's a church I want to be a part of. It sounds so easy. It sounds so positive. It sounds so desirable. Here's my question. Why is it that so few churches are this kind of a church? Why is it that so few churches are connecting to one another in love and service? Why is that? I'll give you a couple of reasons. One is because it's made up of people. Another reason, it's made up of spiritually immature people. Another reason churches don't have this is that there are personality conflicts. Another reason is because of a lack of participation in the church. People attend but don't engage and participate. And bottom line, umbrella over and under everything is, well, we're just sinners. Now, here's what I want to say to us this morning. This type of church where love and service are at the forefront of interpersonal relationships among people that one another, it's possible. It's available. It's what God is calling His church to be. And even though so few churches fit the bill, I'm hoping, I'm praying, I'm working, our staff is working, our leaders are working to make sure that these things describe Ridgecrest Baptist Church. You may say amen to that this morning. That's what we are working towards. So let's take just a minute this morning, and as we think about connecting to one another, looking at these one another verses in the New Testament, let's talk about loving and serving each other. First of all, let's look at this statement, this value. We will love generously. We will love generously. I hope you know this, but being created in the image of God, we are created for relationship. God created us not to be lone rangers, but to be in relationship, in life, and also in our faith. We're created to be in a relationship with God individually through our salvation, and we're also called to be in relationship with other believers who share the same faith as us. And as we do that, as we demonstrate that, then we find ourselves in between our salvation and our going to heaven and living forever in glory. We find ourselves in this time frame of the rest of our lives on earth with the opportunity to one another. And we do that by loving each other generously. Let me share with you some of these one another Bible verses. And as I do, I want you to think about your own life and think about, are these characteristics that are demonstrated in how you live? And as I mentioned these characteristics, are they characteristics you can identify in others? Do you see it in others? Do you see it in yourself? And ultimately, what steps need to take place for me to demonstrate these? The first one I'll mention is loving one another. I shared this just a minute ago. Loving one another. Now, if something's in the Bible one time and one time only, it's important. This is God speaking to us. If that same thing is in the Bible two times, then God has spoken and God has reminded. If that same thing is in the Bible three times, God is trying to get our attention. If it's in the Bible four times, then perhaps God is saying, hey, don't be a hardhead like some of these disciples were. You need to pay attention to this. If it's in the New Testament 16 times, like the statement and the command to love one another, we come to understand that loving one another is a priority. There are so many people that are inside the church. They're believers in Jesus. They attend a local church. They're part of a body of believers. And for whatever reason, they don't have a sense of being loved by the others who are in the church with them. There are other people in the church that when they see somebody, doesn't matter who they are, they're going to make a beeline to them and they're going to love on them. We need to get those two people together. Loving one another is a bedrock, hallmark, testimony, and witness of the church, unlike anything else that will ever take place. Another one another that we are to do. Forgive one another. Forgiveness is such a wonderful quality. And we all think it's great if you forgive somebody, but we each of us understand why it's so hard for me to forgive somebody. There's some things that are pretty easy to forgive. If you cut me off in the drive-thru line at Bojangles, I probably will forgive you. Is that an amen back there? If you say something slanderous about me, it's going to be harder to extend forgiveness. If you do something ugly to me, it's going to be harder to forgive you. But whether it's the drive-thru line at Bojangles or a word that you say or something that you do, I'm still compelled by Scripture and by the example of Jesus to be forgiving. That scripture reference there for forgiveness, Ephesians 4:32, reminds us to be kind, tenderhearted, and forgiving of one another. Easier said than done. Can I get an amen to that? But do that because God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. There's nothing you will ever be called upon to forgive of somebody else that God has not forgiven vastly more than that of you and me. Forgive one another. I'll make this point. In the average church in America, made up of diverse people that love Jesus and that brings them together, in the average church in America, my opinion is that if love and forgiveness would break out among the one another people in the church, revival would come. Right there. That's just 2 of 59. We're told also in Scripture, be patient with one another. That's so hard to do, to extend grace towards the flaws of somebody else, to extend grace towards a new believer or somebody that's really making an effort to step forward in their faith, but they stumble and they bumble sometimes, and it's so much easier just to say, listen, you just go over there and come back when you've got it right with Jesus. We're already set over here. We don't need you in this group. It's easier to say that, but we're not called to say that. We're called to be patient and encouraging of others as they work through their own spiritual growth and development. Aren't you thankful that somebody was patient with you? Comfort one another. That's a good one. Comfort one another. If we started right over here on the front row and went row by row to the back, then all row by row to the front, row by row to the back, and ask people to share for 30 seconds about what the difficulties they're facing are, we'd be here till tomorrow. We all have difficulties. Some very public, we all know about them. Some very private struggle that we're facing. And when we see somebody or we know something, we're compelled as believers to offer comfort to that person. It might be a smile. It might be a good old Christian hug. It might be an email, a phone call. You might be calling somebody up and saying, listen, I'm bringing a meal over tomorrow afternoon. I just need to know what you like and what you don't like. And when they say, well, you don't need to do that, and you respond back and say, well, you can tell me what you like or don't like, or you just have to get what I bring you. Because I'm bringing you something. Words, actions, prayers, comfort. In fact, in addition to comforting one another, we're called to pray for one another. To pray for one another. I'm going to do something kind of spur of the moment. Just kind of see what happens. In just a minute, I'm going to ask if anybody here would like for us to pray for you to stand up. I'm going to ask you to do that in just a minute. If you're here and you just got a burden to pray, might be something for yourself, something for somebody else. You just got a burden and you'd like to be prayed for. I'm not going to ask you to identify what it is. I'm not going to single you out or call you out. I'm just going to, whoever wants to can stand, and that'll be a testimony that we need to pray for each other. And I'm going to offer a generic prayer for anybody that would like to be prayed for. And then after our service, you know, I hope you know, our prayer team will be here at the front. Our staff will be available. Our deacons are available. But right here in the middle of this message, as I'm reminding you and perhaps even informing you that we are to pray for each other, I wonder if you have a burden this morning, a prayer request this morning, something on your heart this morning that you would just be willing to stand up, and by your standing, you're just acknowledging, I've got a prayer need. Would you just pray for me? Would anybody just do that right now? Just stand up? Anybody? Okay. What a reminder of both the needs of people for prayer, the opportunity that we have to pray, and to recognize that for all of us, there are times that we need to be the first one to stand up, and there are other times that things are going well and we can just stay seated. But either way, we are called, we're compelled to pray for each other. Just before I pray, let me encourage you. When you need prayer, when you're facing struggles, when you're going through whatever you're going through, find somebody that you love and you trust and connect with that person and say, would you pray for me? And when you do so, you can say, listen, I'm not going to tell you the details. Would you just pray for me? Or you can say, if you got 45 minutes, I'm going to come over and pour my heart out, and then I want you to pray for me. Either way is fine. We just need to be people who pray for each other. Amen? Let's pray right now. Lord, thank you that in the midst of one anothering one another, we're called to pray for one another. And right now, Lord, for whatever reason people have stood, I pray that they might know your presence, your peace, your spirit, your comfort. I pray, Lord, that right now, whoever has stood up for whatever reason, whether it be medical or financial or relational or 100 other things, Lord, I pray that they might know that you are walking with them through the difficult times, and that they might experience the comfort that only comes through the Holy Spirit and the peace that you give. And Lord, as opportunity presents, and as we would be willing to step forward, even awkwardly, to ask someone else to pray specifically for us, may we be willing to take those steps. We'll thank you even now for this privilege of prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for that. You know, some of these one another verses are positive, things that we should do. Some of them are in the negative, things that we should not do. I wish it was natural just to, you know, when you accept Christ as Savior, all of a sudden your life is changed and transformed, and you're a perfectly mature believer in Christ, and you just float around in the clouds all day until you're called up to heaven. It's not that way. So these one another verses are there to remind us and teach us how we should be and also how we should not be. For example, in one place in Galatians 5, it says, if you keep on biting and devouring each other, this is a church. If you keep on being disgruntled, if you keep on tearing each other apart, you will be destroyed by one another. If you keep acting like your old self, and if you keep minimizing the gospel and maximizing your differences and exerting your personalities and downplaying everything about Christ, if you keep doing that in a church, it's going to tear your church apart. I hate to say this, but as I was studying this week, several names of actual churches came to mind. We're reminded and taught, don't do this. Don't slander one another, it says. Don't grumble against each other. You know what grumbling sounds like? When I count to three, I want you to say the word grumble under your breath four times. Ready? One, two, three. That's exactly what it sounds like right there. Grumbling. Don't grumble against each other. And let me conclude this part by just reminding you again of 16 times where the Scripture tells us in the New Testament to love one another. And when we do that generously, guess what happens? Heaven comes down, and we are strengthened in our faith. My wife Pam, among other studies that she does, she reads regularly from a ministry called She Reads Truth. And this week, she sent me a quote from Jessica Lamb connected with She Reads Truth. Here's what Jessica Lamb says. I don't think I'm alone in feeling like life with other believers is often easier read about than lived. The family of God is messy. I'm going to say that again. The family of God is messy. I'm going to ask you to say that part with me. Ready? The family of God is messy. We're a desperate group of individuals from every imaginable nation, ethnicity, family circumstance, and political affiliation. Each one of us has a story, and we bring our own history of wounds and wounding to the family table. Thankfully, this isn't new or surprising to God. From the first disciples in the early church to our current cultural movement, the body of Christ has always been made up of believers who have no real reason for living in community together outside of the one reason that changes everything, Jesus. Jesus brings each one of us mismatched pieces into something meticulously crafted and beautiful, His people, the body of Christ. And when that happens, people on the outside that know us before and they know what we were like, now they see what's happened in our life and in the lives of others. They look at us and they say, what in the world has gotten a hold of them? And then they find out the answer is Jesus. We will love generously. Secondly, we will serve joyfully. These one another verses, and I've just shared a few of those with you. I've listed them all on your listening guide. These one another verses also relate specifically to some of the jobs or tasks or needs within the church. For example, the need of teaching and preaching is addressed by these one another verses. Speak the truth in love to one another. Teach one another, encourage one another, exhort one another, admonish one another, build up one another, stir up one another to love and good works. All these are part of the teaching and preaching ministry of the church. Whether it's the pastor on the pulpit or a Connect group leader or an Awana leader or any number of different ways that we teach the scriptures. Greeters are addressed here. Greet one another, it says in Romans. Greet one another with a holy kiss. I like that one. Greet one another with a holy kiss. I asked somebody one time, I said, what exactly is a holy kiss? They said, have you ever seen when two people greet each other, two ladies in particular, and they don't want to mess up their makeup, but they want to kiss each other? So they just kind of do that little air kiss, you know, like that. That's a holy kiss. Whether you know somebody or not, make sure that person feels greeted in the church when they come in. There should be nobody that makes it to a chair without being greeted by multiple people, either saying, hey man, good to see you again, or hey man, tell me your name. It's good to see you here for the first time. Either way, we should be a greeting people. Member care is addressed in these verses. Care for one another, serve one another, bear one another's burdens, bear with one another. Hospitality, opening our homes or being there for others to have fellowship. It says in 1 Peter 4, show hospitality to one another. Prayer is addressed. Pray for one another. Confess your faults to one another. Worship is addressed. Speak to one another, speak with one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. I love how we do that in this place, by the way. And then generically, if you have an ability and there is a need, then take your ability and plug it into that need and just jump in wherever the need is and express your desire to be a part of the body of Christ. In 1 Peter 4:10, employ the gifts that God has given us for the benefit of one another. That's how we should act and work in the life of the church. Let me wrap up with a couple of things. One is this, that as believers in Jesus and members of Ridgecrest Baptist Church, I want to encourage us to love one another generously. Can I encourage you to do that today? Now, if you're here for the first time, I want to let you know, I'm not saying this as a result of some big church fight we had. We've not had a big church fight. I'm saying this as a reminder to all of us who are Christians, as an instruction to those of us who have never heard it before. But can we not be motivated and determined among ourselves that we will love one another generously as we connect to one another as part of Ridgecrest Baptist Church? Let me encourage you, be on the lookout to make those connections in love. Be on the lookout to be generous with somebody. Don't wait for somebody to come up to you before you would go up to them. You make it your point to be a one-person welcoming committee, hospitality committee, greeting committee, praying committee, whatever it is. Just be that person that's going to love generously. Be that way to people you know and to people that you've just met. My experience over the years in the various churches I've been a part of in ministry, and all of them have been blessings, but there have been times in every church that I've come across somebody who's gotten upset that nobody one-anothered them. Nobody brought me a meal. Nobody did this and that. And listen, we should be doing those things. There should be no excuse for letting somebody down. But my experience has been those who complain about not being one another are typically those that don't want one another to start with. It took me a while to practice that and to say it this week. I heard about one Sunday a pastor challenged his congregation to show love towards the meanest person they know of. And that same day, 94 people lined up to speak to the same person after church. A line out the door and around the hallway. As believers and members of Ridgecrest Baptist Church, can I encourage us and challenge us not only to love each other generously, but to serve each other joyfully, to get involved? Today at 4 o'clock, our ministry staff and our ministry team leaders, we're going to meet together down the hall, and we're going to talk about ministry needs and ministry opportunities and ways that we can minister and serve one another joyfully in the coming days at Ridgecrest Baptist Church. You'll hear more and more about this in the coming days. I'm excited about it. There's an opportunity now that we're kind of coming out of COVID. We're kind of regrouping along with a lot of other churches. It's a time to kind of turn a page, to refresh, to relaunch, like we're doing in so many other areas, but especially in our areas of loving each other and serving each other. You'll hear more about this in the weeks to come. The benefits of loving. If we determine that we're going to love each other generously, what's going to happen? Well, first of all, we're going to identify ourselves as believers without having to say a word. But listen, saying a word is always good. But we're identifying ourselves. How many times has somebody rightly labeled a Christian as a hypocrite because they say one thing and they act another? So when we act out our love and then talk about the reason for that love, it gives us a powerful testimony as a believer. It meets needs. It encourages and strengthens our own self and those around us. And by loving each other, we become attractive to those who don't yet know Jesus. There's benefits of serving. When we serve, we advance the gospel. Our mission is advanced when all the positions of leadership and service are filled. Our mission advances when people are doing the things that God calls us to do. We are strengthened to the point where now we can overflow and reach out to others because there are no gaps in our midst. Our church is more healthy when people are finding their place of joyful service. And study after study after study shows that members who serve are more involved, more satisfied, and the churches are more successful when members joyfully serve. What an encouragement that is for all of us. I hope you'll be looking for those opportunities in the days to come. This past week, I was alerted to an article in the Wall Street Journal written by Jeffrey A. Hall. This is not from a church perspective. This is from a secular perspective. And his take was that in the culture today, people are not relating to one another the way they have in the past. As a whole, not just the church, but people as a whole, he says, are not relating to one another the way they have in the past. He says the following things: interpersonal time in conversation, people just talking to each other, has been declining for over 30 years. He says people are failing at what he calls relationality, which is developing relationship, knowing each other, relating to each other, communicating with each other, bonding with each other, connecting with each other. That's not happening as it has been in the past, and he says our culture is paying a price for that. And then he says this: people today are more involved with social media and less involved with social interaction. I think that's probably true. So here's my point. In reading this article this week, I thought, well, here's a cultural, secular observation and study. This guy's did the studies and the research. On one hand, saying that in the culture, people are not connected the way they were. And on the other hand, as believers, we're called to be connected to one another for our own growth, for the health of our church, and for outreach into a world that desperately needs Christ. If there's ever been an avenue that would open up for us to both set an example for our culture and reach out into our culture. Wow. All we have to do, there's more, but among the easier things to do is simply one another. Love and serve. And when people who are disconnected, and remember what I said earlier, God created us for relationship. And when we're not in relationship, we experience negative consequences. Jeffrey Hall pointed out while saying we're paying a price for not being as connected as we were. He didn't realize it, but he's exactly biblically accurate. So what an opportunity we have to simply be the Christians God has called us to be and be the church God has called us to be and see how God can use us in great and wonderful ways. If you're able, I want to invite you to stand with me, and I'm going to pray for us as our service concludes, and somehow, some way that you feel compelled to want somebody to talk with you further, to pray with you, more than just the standing up we did a few minutes ago. If you'd like somebody to interact with you in some way, then our prayer team will be across the front. They'll have little badges on. They would love to connect and pray with you in any way you would like to. Our other staff and deacons and connect group leaders will all be around as well. But as we leave today, why not take just a minute? Look for somebody to show some love. Find somewhere that you can serve. Let's pray together. Thank you, our Heavenly Father, for the wonderful encouragement of the 59 one another verses that we find in the New Testament. Lord, may we determine that we're going to take that honestly and seriously, and we're going to direct our steps towards one anothering others so that we might be blessed, that we might bless others, and that we might be a witness and a testimony for Christ. Lord, may your church be strengthened. May your name be glorified. May your people be strengthened and motivated to set the example and shine the light of Jesus here and around the world as we pray in that name, the most wonderful name of all, the name of Jesus. Amen.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name. stand against. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
What a beautiful name it is. He is so holy, so holy. And we are called to be holy as He is holy. So let's pray for each other today and our one another's. Pray for each other this week, that we would live lives worthy of the calling of Christians. Have a great week. We love you.